offered land on long-term lease basis to any peasant who would work it. Hardly anyone took him up on that offer. And those who did have been the object of terrible venom. Because what is socialism but an envy society? And that's what we are becoming, a society that legislates envy. Envy by the blacks of the whites, by the Hispanics of the whites, by the poor whites of the rich whites, by the educated of the uneducated. We are ruled by envy. Our legislation is legislated envy. Well, there they've had 70 years or more of envy entrenched. And anyone who tries to make it on his own is hated, subject to reprisals. And the same is true in Central Europe. So, you're not going to overcome envy without a return to the Word of God. And we need a return to it here as in the Soviet Union, because we are now a society based on envy. All our legislation. And that's, of course, what is destroying the Soviet Union. It's falling apart. It's trying privatization. But privatization doesn't work without a work ethic. And if envy is there, and you're succeeding, and there's hatred and reprisals against you for succeeding, how can you get ahead? Ever hear about the potlatches of the Northwest Indians? Well, the potlatches, when an Indian got rich and prosperous, and he accumulated a lot more furs and a lot more food than anybody else, he had to have a big dinner and give away everything to everybody. Or else he'd be killed. Because those tribes were ruled by envy. And if you got to be better than anyone else, then you had to die unless you gave it away. And that's what we're coming to. And that's what our papers incite in us. That's what the media incites. We're all the villains on television. They're rich men. They're white men. They're businessmen. They're Christians. Hatred against those who are godly and successful. That's a society of envy. And envy is totally destructive. And the world is increasingly ruled by it. So it's going to be judged by the Lord.
Are you familiar with Sutton's five-point model of the covenant?
I am. I've read it half a dozen times, at least, maybe 20 times. And 3 minutes later, I can't remember it, because I can't see any connection with that, what the Bible is teaching. It's an artificial construct. One of the most deadliest things ever passed. It was passed earlier this year. 18 frozen food plants are in the process of moving into Mexico because the act would wipe them out. And they're not harming the environment. So business is leaving the country wholesale. Under our bubblehead governor, Jerry Brown. Some rules and regulations were passed. And we were a big tire manufacturing state. There isn't one tire maker left in the state of California. Very good friend of mine. Moved some years ago to the city where his business took him. There was not a single church there where he could worship. Not a single one. He found all he could do was to worship in his home with his wife and son, listen to tapes. Because if he went anywhere else, instead of leaving with a worshipful attitude, he left upset and angry. And he felt it was anything but helpful. Sadly, that is true in some cities. I think then, just as in the Old Testament, the father is the priest, carried on the worship of the family. The father must take charge, teach his children, and hope and pray that a church develops. There are some churches, good-sized ones, that have developed out of home churches. It is a very difficult problem now. And I've heard of some very heartbreaking cases. So many of the mainline churches are taken over. And where is a man to go? I know one man who drove, this was a few years back, 50 miles to go to a church that was thoroughly reformed. They had him up on charges because he was driving 100 miles a day to go and come to church. They felt that was a violation of the Sabbath. He was heartbroken. He said, I found the one place where they truly believe the reformed faith, preached it faithfully, and where I could have some fellowship, and they treat me like that. So, there are heartbreaking cases of people who have problems finding a church. And I think it would be a good thing if some of the denominations would start something like a, just as we have home church schooling programs, a home churching program, whereby a home church could be carried on by people who are alone. Now, the early settlers felt so strongly about this that they actually did not allow people to move to New England out to the frontier until they could find some young man who could go out with them to be a pastor. But they felt a real responsibility. And I recall some years ago reading about this one pastor who led a handful of farmers out to the frontier. And the men built the church, came together as he taught them, just a handful of farmers. And he started to build the house. And he was out on the roof putting on the shingles, getting ready to get his wife, whose name was Dolly Battles. And farmer called out, "What are you doing, pastor?" He said, "Preparing for battle."
Could you comment on your relationship with Dr. North and specifically on the essay, The Marriage Feast of the Land?
Supper. You read?
No, I haven't read it. So I can't comment on it since I haven't read it.
The reason I ask is because I have talked to Dr. North and to associates of his, and I've been told that you two are no longer on speaking terms because of that essay.
Well, when I got it, it didn't have that title, and I have the original text in my file. He wrote a paper on the Passover. And his thesis, which he got from James Jordan, and which Ray Sutton backed, said that the Passover lamb and its blood that was put on the door symbolized the blood of a virgin on her marriage night, hymeneal blood. And I said, this is fertility cult nonsense, paganism. And I rejected it. And I said, you've really gone astray with this. Jim Jordan wrote a rather insulting letter and said I had sexual hang-ups. That's why I didn't agree with that thesis. I said the scripture plainly tells us that Christ is our Passover lamb. So that blood signified the blood of Christ, not of a virgin on a bridal night. I felt that it was blasphemous, and I still do. So he, whatever other version he has published of that, I have the original text. He sent it around to a number of people for confirmation of his feeling he was right. And I heard from them what they thought. But unhappily, Jim Jordan was the originator of that, and it was in his dissertation, which was approved by Meredith Kline at Westminster. So that tells you something about Meredith Kline. Ironically, now, Gary North, in his most recent book on Westminster, which has some good things in it, is very critical of Meredith Kline. That's where they got their thinking.